Ernest Edelman. First of all, let me thank the organizers, Speed Plaza, for giving me the opportunity for being here today. It's a great pleasure. The topic of my today's speech is transfer of know-how in the emerging Chinese speed market, synergies and difficulties between overseas and local teams. These are the points of my presentation. First of all, we will start with a roadmap of the CSP Chinese development. We will continue with the solar resource potential in China. I will give you an overview of the overseas CSP experience until now, that is, the main technologies, install capacities, main references. We will see the main drivers and barriers within the Chinese market that every EPC contractor, technology provider, or every company that will face that. In order to come up with a proper execution strategy, we need to find a proper combination between overseas and local teams. We will see the most important points regarding synergies and difficulties that every company needs to face. Communications and cultural differences is one of the most important points here and need to be well addressed. We will see the future opportunities in China, and I will conclude with my conclusions. Here you see how Molyparsons are presenting the roadmap in terms of China CSP development. I mean, with the 20 demonstration plants, it's a fact that the construction of a CSP plant is a real challenge that requires really seeking support, material support, experience support from an overseas technical team. The intellectual property, we need to be protected. This is, we need to pay attention to that. And as the industry starts to develop, the cost should be reduced. And the risk should be minimized, helping the business really to grow and acquiring more products in the pipeline, helping us to really acquire more lessons learned. And we need to develop this learning curve. This whole roadmap that you see here has been developed for countries such as the US and Spain. And China shouldn't take a rush on this, so every milestone needs to fulfill to really succeed on the project. So I'm going to bring an appropriate team on board and to succeed in the market. I'm sure you're aware, and you have been attending to the previous day conferences during the last days, so you're well aware about the amount of gigawatts installed, the feeding types, the completion dates, so I'm not going to go in very much detail about the CSP Chinese development program. I just only want to show you the solar resource potential in China. We have seen this map is familiar for all of us, I think. But just let me show you the obviously the maximum levels of solar radiation there in the west part and northwest, so the Inner Mongolia and the Tibet area. One thing here to remark is that obviously the potential is on the west part and the power demand is on the east. So that means a west-to-east power transmission line to be developed. In addition to this, well, Tibet is an area well known for natural resources, so that means there are some limitations really to the developers in this area, so this needs to be taken into consideration. Let's move on now in terms of the CSP main technologies. As you all know, there are three main CSP technologies, which are parabolic trough, solar tower, and inner Fresnel. Here you see the install capacities per region. significant what you see here in green color, the projects under development, red under construction, and blue under operation. Significant experience has been accumulated in projects such as Spain and US, we all know that. So smooth transfer of know-how and experience should occur between those countries and China. We know there is a huge potential to develop projects in China, but this is a transfer of know-how in the group. Here just some references for parabolic trough with Solana in the US and the Sol in Spain. These just are some references. In terms of solar tower, we know that the solar tower technology is much more complex than parabolic trough. So this is mainly the reason why the number of references are lower in comparison to parabolic trough. You see here some examples: PS10, PS20, and FEMA Solar in Spain, both. And here at the bottom, Crescent News in Nevada Desert in the US. I must say here that significant experience and lessons learned have been acquired, but we need to develop, we need to learn more, especially by facing operational problems. We need to develop further these lessons learned, especially within this technology. Let's move on and talk about the drivers in China. I think this is important. Well, first of all, China is world leader in clean energy technologies such as PV and wind. The market is clearly dominated by five large state holdings. They are listed here. They are state-owned companies. China has the highest energy demand across the globe. The investment capacity is not an issue, and the manufacturing capacity is also there. We have been seeing during the last days that we are familiar with these sort of values. The TNI is pretty high. It's between 1800 and 2500 kilowatt hours square meter per year. And the areas we saw the highest potential solar radiation areas in my previous slide. In terms of barriers, energy transportation is one of the major elements in China. Currently, China's ultra-high voltage power transmission line is one of the biggest investments worldwide. The technology is not still mature, and this is mainly the reason why the costs are still high. Water supply could be an issue, especially in remote areas, and a specific policy framework needs to be in place. Let me move on now and talk about the synergies. If we want to succeed really in the Chinese market, we need to find a good symbiotic relationship between the overseas and the local teams. To really succeed in the market. So I just want to bring to your attention a simple definition about what synergy it's simply saying the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. So that means I encourage all the parties here to really join forces to find a great team, to really bring the best team players or actors in place to really succeed into the market. China has a large manufacturing capacity, being very competitive in manufacturing cost. So that means majority of the equipment and services can be delivered from China. And one of the things is that the higher will be the local content, the lower will be the investment cost. And this is really an advantage when we develop projects in China. The other advantage of synergy that we need to explore is the lower cost capabilities and workforce. here is just an example of a 50 megawatt parabolic truck. What you see on the left hand side, majority of the services and components are delivered in China. And on the right hand side, you see the overseas company scope. So by doing that, we can get a cost reduction of between 30 and 40% if we compare to a project executed in the US and Spain. So this is just an example. I must say also that there are some key components that need to be really supplied from the overseas company just to minimize the risk. This should be taken into consideration as well. Within the 20 demonstration plants of the first phase, 50% of the projects will be solar power technology. So let me share with you a typical CSP tower plant, a typical scope of services between overseas and local team, or local teams. On the right hand side, you see the overseas company scope of services. We recommend really that the overseas company take the lead on the key equipment. The key equipment, we understand the tower, the solar field, the steam generation system, receiver, thermal energy storage, and DCS. Obviously, the tower, the overseas company will recommend that takes control of the overall design. But the construction needs to be under the local company umbrella. This is a fact. Let me move on now and talk about difficulties and risk by developing projects in China. On the right hand side, let me bring you through the different project categories. And on the right hand side, I will share with you the most important risk that we as well the person recently anticipate. Regarding engineering, we touched on this, so we know that there is a lack of experience and technology, but simply the learning curve needs to be developed. In terms of procurement, due to the large number of projects that will come in line at the same time, there is a high risk of scarcity in terms of materials, man labor. So in terms of the suppliers, what we recommend is really that you guys conduct a market study to really understand which are the manufacturing capacities within the region. So let's take the region, you are going to develop your project, so let's do anticipate that beforehand, do a market study to understand if the suppliers they have enough capacity. One of the lessons learned from the previous projects which are under execution in terms of tower CSP is that there is one example, there is one project that they have been facing huge problems in terms of the steel structure. So, and there is a scarcity of really not only manufacturing steel structure workshop, but also galvanizing capabilities. So, please pay attention to that. In terms of procurement, also we recommend that you conduct a vendors pre-qualification process, that you really guys select those vendors who has really experience and reputation in the market, just simply to minimize the risk. Here at the bottom, in terms of construction, we recommend that the local team who is really local team overseas company and the local team, the overseas I touched with before, which are the key components I think the overseas company need to take care of. But the company who is simply conduct the construction of the key components need to have CSP experience. This is our recommendation. We talked about this earlier with our conditions yesterday during the panel discussion. There was some interesting questions and answers. So the severe weather conditions is one of the topics to be addressed. A plan needs to be put in place to really anticipate to this point. Let's let's talk about commissioning. I mean, commissioning, we all know, is always a big issue. All the defects come at a later stage, at the end of the project. So, for example, in terms of the Eurostat's calibration, we recommend that you start doing the calibration as soon as possible during the construction, that you really minimize the risk of really getting delayed during the commissioning. Some plants which are under operation, it took nearly a year to really commission the whole solar field, so this needs to be taken into account. Areas like SDS, receiver, multi soil tanks are some of the areas we need to focus on. In terms of operation, one of the important points is having proximity to the workforce, having adequate roadways to access to the site. Secondly, please recruit bring on board operators who have experience on the CSP. I mean, here in China there are a lot of thermal plants, combined cycle, but it's slightly different as a CSP plant, so requires certain expertise. In terms of the very low temperatures, in terms of operation, we recommend to have some kind of day and night mode, having heat tracing and the free system, not only on the molten salts, but also on the steam cycle or auxiliary systems. Let me now talk about prey management. This is one of the areas where really more personal vision I think is very critical. I mean, these type of projects, EPC projects, they have a variety of stakeholders, so really an adequate division of responsibility and interface management, strong interface management is required. Communications, stakeholders, and risk management are also some of the areas where we need to focus on to really manage the project correctly. There is, the local team should really acquire some kind of contract management culture to really minimize the economic impact at the end of the project. At the end of the day, we all know that all these projects have claims, change orders, so let's try to anticipate that and build up some kind of contract management culture. Quality and health and safety. Well, we have our time schedule here in China. We all know that the projects need to be completed by the end of 2018. I believe, and I said also yesterday, that this is a tight schedule. Normally, tower CSP plant is around 40 months to be fully completed and fully commissioned. We are talking here about 2 years, so this is really a challenge. But what I want to stress is the importance of really not to take shortcuts on quality and health and safety. This is not a liability issue. I mean, this will be an advantage down the line. I mean, if we don't really invest or make some efforts really to really invest time in quality and health and safety, we can have problems down the line, increased oil and cost, reduced lifetime, malfunctioning of the plan, and much more, and above all, fatalities and accidents. Towers, CSP race, and the risk in terms of the tower construction, so please take into account this point. Last but not least, communications. I personally believe this is one of the major points that we need to address and we need to sort it out. We have a clear language barrier here between European countries and China. So, well, at the end of the day, we need to have cross-cultural teams and address this issue. Let me illustrate what I understand as a cultural difference. I'm sure some of you have ever been in this situation before, yeah? You don't know how to react, how to behave. Well, it happened to me personally when I started working with Chinese. and you know that I need to keep the business going 2 months. So it's just simply a matter of respect for what's in the other. So this is just a few examples of what we understand as a cultural difference. This is what Luis says in terms of the different cultural types, and I think I really like this slide. Let me show you the different cultural models that Luis describes. First of all, is the linearity, the cultural type. Here is where we see the US, Germany, Norway, Switzerland. He describes people here from these countries like cool, factual, the discipliners. On top, we have the multi-active cultural model. This is where we see it in the Spaniards. This is something he's described. He describes people here like emotional, impulsive. And finally, we have the reactive model, where it sits in China. Luis describes the people here like kind of accommodating compromises, good listeners. They give good value to the long relationships. Here it's important that we understand that if, for example, there is a Spanish company and a Chinese company, we need to find some kind of middle point to really find a compromise to work together. So we need, empathy really takes a big role here. And at the end of the day, for the benefit of everybody, we need to build bridges across the countries. So we want to succeed and bring these projects, move forward with these projects. This is what Bert Hofstede says about cultural dimensions. I'm not going to go in very big detail. I just only want to show you. Here you see the different countries on the left hand side, and here are the cultural dimensions. There is one important cultural dimension, which is long-term orientation, which you see here is significantly higher in comparison to other countries. It surprises me when I saw this graph. That means simply that by doing business in China, negotiation is one of the issues. It takes time to close a deal. And the person needs to be patient, especially when we are on the other side, when we are foreigners overseas. This is not just straightforward, so it requires a little bit of patience, empathy, and to close the deal. In terms of, we talk about the cultural differences, but let me move on now more specifically on working culture. How worthy persons and vision can really bridge this gap between overseas and local teams. It's just by simply having a broader spectrum of offices and incubators across the country. We have more than 1,200 VPs. Majority of them they are bilingual, so English is not an issue. They can deal with that. We have 6 offices across the country. They have been dealing with international projects for the last 14 years, and this simply makes a good combination. This is really an advantage for us, for the persons in Spain. Dr. Hilaire and myself and the rest of the team in Madrid, having on board really our Chinese colleagues. So, as I said in my previous slides, we combine the local, the know-how, the expertise in Spain, where we have really employees who has a long experience in the CSP sector. They have a good reputation, and majority of them they have worked in the main CSP players like Alibaba, Cobra, Senar. And then on the other side, we have our Chinese colleagues who really know the local regulations. They can deal with the language barrier, the cultural differences, and much more. They can understand what the client needs. So a lot of this really makes a good combination for us to develop it with success, successfully. In terms of future opportunities, I mean, I think we all know that the opportunities are huge here in China. That's why we are here. Just some examples. I mean, the Chinese market incentives is one of the examples. China also being a potential export hub, not only for domestic but also international projects. We have been discussing during the last 10 days that I personally believe if Spain US took like 10-15 years to develop this learning curve, I dare to say that China, I could imagine 5-6 years, you guys will be able to develop this learning curve. And at that moment, really will be the time when you guys can really develop projects overseas, bring your companies to work, but actually, this is already happening in the Middle East, so it's just only a matter of time. I already said before, I mean, there's an opportunity really for Chinese companies to develop this learning curve by working in conjunction with overseas companies. Companies who are really in the front line at this moment will have a competitive advantage in the near future. In terms of opportunities, I mean, there are some opportunities in regards to distributed solar energy system. Projects of integrated solar combined cycle can be developed. China currently operates a large number of fossil fuel plants, so this can be an opportunity we need to combine and to find the synergies. Let me conclude here some of the most important conclusions of my presentation. China has an ambitious plan. I mean, we have now the 13-5-year plan. We have the first phase, it will come up the second phase. The market is developing quickly, so it's just only a matter of time. I put in my first slide the roadmap. So it just needs to take care about fulfilling the main milestones to succeed. Learning curve and project management practices need to be adopted. And support from overseas companies is essential. We mentioned that China is leading in clean energy technologies such as PV and wind, so why China cannot be also leading in CSP? There is a strong investment capacity in the country, and manufacturing capacity is one of the main advantages. Significant effort needs to be taken on technology and cost development, and obviously a strong policy required. Strong policy is required as well. We touched based on the language and cultural differences, so reconciliation and cultural diversity is an important point. And finally, China, as I mentioned, can be an export hub not only for domestic and international companies. So just as a conclusion, take your time to develop the learning curve, fulfill the different milestones, and I mean, I think you are there. Thank you for your attention. Here are my contact details. Also, my colleague Dr. John is here, Dr. Hilaire, so if you're possible, we'll be very glad to assist you. If you have any questions, queries, thanks a lot and enjoy the rest of the conference.